In a previous video, I showed you the bedside table here, loosely based on a washstand. It's made out of reclaimed pine, and it's a very rustic piece, put together very quickly, and it's supposed to look, you know, like a country piece, like it's been around the block a few times. So, to finish this piece, what we're going to do is the bottom is going to be stained and clear coated, and I'll show you how we're going to do that. And the top is going to be finished with milk paint. In a two-tone process, and I'll show you that too. So let's start with the bottom. Alright, if you've ever stained pine before, you know that using Minwax and oil-based stains like that can be troublesome because you get blotchiness in the wood and it just doesn't stain evenly. So what I do for softwoods is use a dye first. This is an aniline dye. It's RD Company or Artacetal is the brand. And what this is just a powder which comes like that, and you mix it with warm water. I usually use a glass jar like this, and you can alter the strength of the stain just by altering the amount of water in it. And I've done a few samples here to find out what I want. We're actually going to use something similar to this, and this dye is going to be the first color coat on the base of our unit here, and after that we're going to seal it, and then we're going to add some more distressing. So let's start with this dye. First time you use this dye, when it dries, which dries pretty quickly, you look at it and think, oh my god, what an awful finish. It looks dull and just blah. But that's just the base color. We're going to build from that. Next thing we want to do is use a shellac, which is alcohol based and which is compatible with all types of finishes, water or oil. And we're going to put this shellac on top of the dye to seal it, and then we're going to build on top of the shellac. So I'm just going to brush this on next. Okay, at this point on our cabinet, we've made the dye stain as our base layer, and we put a coat of shellac on, which is very thin, but it's just enough to seal the dye in. And the next step is we want to add some age to this piece by putting using gel stain as a glaze on top of the finish that we just put on. So I've taken a Scotch-Brite pad and just rubbed this down a little bit just to get it smooth, and now I'll use this gel stain selectively in areas where I think it should be darker or lighter. You know, I'll darken some areas and leave other areas as they are, and that'll just age this thing a little bit further and just add a little more depth and character to it. Now, when I glaze, I usually want to go with the green so that it looks realistic, and you can see it's just gonna, certain areas that I want to add something to, but I'm not doing it everywhere. Anywhere where there's a hole, I want to fill that in a little more. I have a brush here, I can fill holes in pretty deeply. And the idea is just to add a little more character to the piece. And once that sits for a minute, you can just rub it off, blend it in. If you don't like it at all, you can just rub the whole thing off. As I'm doing this glazing process, I mean, I've done the dark walnut stain, which almost makes the wood look burned. It's a nice black look to it, and it definitely helps add some variation to it. And in areas like where this pole is, where it might get worn off by hands, you know, I'm just using sandpaper. You can see the sandpaper is getting all gummed up by the glaze, and that's good. It actually adds texture, like over here. If you look at the piece itself, you know, there's areas like here on the edges where it would be worn more, and I'm taking a little sandpaper to that just to wear through slightly. Same thing over on this side. And there's high spots in the grain which are also getting sanded down, so you see a little bit of the grain come through. And that's just all adding to the distressing and character to this piece. And then when we finish this with a clear coat on top of that, it'll just preserve what's there. For the top coat, you might choose to use a hand-rubbed oil, like a linseed oil or a tongue oil, even a product like Waterlocks. But an easy way to get a kind of a matte or a flat finish that you often see on older pieces is to use a water-based, believe it or not, polyurethane. If you can find either flat or this one's called clear matte, they're very hard to find. They're not sold in a lot of stores, but there are a few manufacturers that still make it. And it leaves a nice flat finish that looks just aged. It has some depth and clarity to it, but it doesn't shine at you and look new. So that's what I'm going to use here, is this water-based polyurethane in a clear matte finish. Okay, the glaze coat has dried. I've done all the distressing that I need to do, and now it's ready for the final coats. I'm going to be using this matte finish polyurethane, so it's a nice flat sheen to it. Now I've switched to a high-quality brush, and I want to be more careful than I was before because the sheen needs to be nice and even so it looks realistic. For the top of our project, we're going to be using milk paint. And milk paint is the most amazing finish. I don't know why it's not used more often, but you can make it look aged, you can make it look new. It's just very, very flexible, very easy to use, quick to use. I use the old-fashioned milk paint company brand. I've used it for many years. And what we're going to be doing with this top is we're going to have two different colors on the top, and one is going to bleed through the other. So basically, we're going to start with this buttermilk, which is kind of an ivory color, and that's going to be our base layer. So we'll do that first. Then we're going to apply a black on top of that, and then we're going to sand through so that some of the buttermilk shows through and even some of the wood shows through. And then we're going to stain that little bit of wood that shows through, and then finally put an oil, a hand-rubbed oil finish on top of the whole thing. So it's multiple sessions, but it goes pretty quick because the stuff is so easy to use and it dries so quickly. What you do is, this stuff comes as a powder. You're going to use a mason jar or some glass jar with warm water. You mix in the amount, either the amount that they recommend on the package, or else you can change that to suit yourself. Sometimes you want a thinner mix or a thicker mix. But once that kind of settles out and you get a nice mix going, then it's just a matter of brushing it on, and it'll dry in literally like 10 or 15 minutes. So let's get started. Well, I've got our hot water here, and I'll just pour in what I think is enough. I want a pretty thick mix here. All right, and then what I do is just put the top onto the mason jar and shake her up. Milk paint is simple to apply. It's very watery. You can use the cheapest brush you can find, it doesn't matter. And literally, you're just gonna slosh it on. The first coat of milk paint is dry now. I actually put a second coat on because I mixed it a little bit thin, but this stuff is very forgiving that way. So this is now chemically bonded to the wood. And what I want to do now is just take a Scotch-Brite pad and just get some of the crunchiness off, because this dries a little bit rough. And we're going to put more milk paint on top of this, but I just want to make it a little bit smoother than it is now. Okay, now that I've brushed this up with a Scotch-Brite pad, I want to put another layer on of milk paint, and this one's going to be black. And this may seem crazy, but later on, we're going to sand through this and let parts of the old milk paint show through and even parts of the wood show through. So let's get this other layer on here. Okay, we have our second coat of milk paint just about dry here. And you can even see some brush marks there, and that's all good. Now what we want to do now is sand through this first layer into the second layer and expose that second color. And in certain areas, like the edges here and here, we're going to sand all the way down to the wood and expose the original wood. So you want to do this carefully and don't go too nuts with it. If you do screw up, you can put more milk paint on there, but just go easy. And you'll notice I'm using some old sandpaper here because it's worn down a little bit and it won't show quite as obviously that it's sandpaper that was used to go through this. So let's get going. Okay, now that we've distressed this with sandpaper and then more Scotch-Brite pad, you can see the old layer of the ivory showing through the black, which is actually more of a gray now, and even some areas here where it's just bare wood. So you could just leave it like this if you wanted to, but I like to put a layer of hand-rubbed oil on top of this. There's a couple different types of oil you could use. You could use tung oil, you could use linseed oil, you could also use this, which is Watco oil, which dries pretty quickly, and this has a little bit of color to it. And that's gonna take to the areas where there's bare wood and help age that even a little bit more. Here's our finish is all done. The milk paint bleeds through from the previous layers and it looks like it has quite a bit of age. Certain areas where there's actually bare wood showing, the Watco oil stain has darkened a little bit and made it look like it is wood underneath. So that definitely looks old and aged. And then if we pull back here, you can see the stain on the bottom on the reclaimed wood all matches pretty nicely. And definitely looks like it has some character, some old age. What I like about this primitive furniture is it's very quick to make. It took maybe an afternoon to make the carcass and the top, and another afternoon to do the finishing. So all very quickly done. And a lot of fun, looks pretty cool, and I hope the new owners get a kick out of it.